That which touches me most is that I had a chance to work with people, passing on to others that which was passed on to me.
Come on.
We believe in freedom and that freedom till it comes.
Good evening. My name is Alessandra Moctezuma, and I'm the gallery director here at Mesa College. Welcome to our exhibit and our lecture. As most of you have come up from the faculty exhibit, where we're showing work from all of our studio, wonderful studio artists who teach in the college. And tonight I invited Professor Robert Sanchez, who teaches painting, art history and art orientation, to talk about his paintings. And I also invited Brian Gillis, who has just joined the art department, who teaches ceramics, to talk about his ceramic work. And I won't take too long since we have two artists and I want to make sure we have time for questions. So here is Robert Sanchez.
I'm supposed to clap when it's over. I know, that's what I said. Okay, before I turn off the lights here and I get started with the slides, I picked a small group of slides, not a lot, considering we don't have a whole lot of time here. And what I've tried to do is present an overview of things that I've done going back to, I think the earliest one that you'll look at here is around 83, 84, somewhere around that time period. And then work from the 80s on up through to relatively recent pieces, not the most recent, because what I'm doing right now, I realize I don't have slides of the current work, but you may have seen, if you were down in the gallery, the other pieces that I have there, the two that I've got in the exhibit. So what I'll do is, what I'm gonna do first is present each one of the slides, tell you a little bit briefly about it. That's mainly things that are just very straightforward, the title, if I can remember it, if it's relevant, the size, and the materials, and I might make a comment here or there. Then once I get through them, I'll come back and maybe talk about a couple of them individually, time permitting, we'll see. What I'd like to do is keep it fairly short so that we can have a few minutes for questions after I present my work, and then I'll let Brian do that with his, obviously, later. So. Okay. I'll let you look at this a minute, and then I'll mention a couple of things about it. First of all, let me say that what I've done for many years, maybe too many that I don't even want to mention here, for many years as an artist, I've been realizing lately is always been painting, even though I ventured into, there's various phrases and terms they use in contemporary art to describe work that isn't just a work on canvas or work on paper. So I have gotten involved in making things that are such as installations, some performance work, collaborative work with other individuals. And what I've come to realize is that almost all of the things that I've done outside of the more traditional formats of painting and drawing are still that. In other words, I guess they've all been informed by my sensibilities and I guess just my own sort of innate experience in using color, texture, light, dark, all those things that are just basically the formal issues of making artworks. And it's, as an artist, I think we all are those artists who work long enough and make work for many years. You sometimes sit back and sort of analyze things and think about them, and other times you question yourself as to whether you're getting into something that is really not what you, let's say, have enough experience in to pull off something that will be successful. But I think the perspective, and this is kind of came about in pulling these slides together, the perspective of looking at this is really all about painting, even though you'll see some various ventures into three dimensions, is a good one because it sort of grounds, at least myself, into that notion of how open-ended painting can be, and it doesn't have to be thought of as just one approach. So this first slide, which is not traditionally in the sense of painting, but was a very large drawing, not quite this large, on paper, charcoal drawing. And charcoal, I always tell my painting students, is something that's fairly close to working with paint medium, or the medium of paint, in that charcoal is very, you can manipulate it a lot on the paper, you can move it around, and you can get surfaces that look like painted surfaces. Unlike, let's say, ink drawing or pencil drawing that can simulate that, but it's much more graphic in the traditional sense of drawing. This is titled Terminal Plot 1. The one designates the fact that there were a series of 10 large-scale drawings, and the originals are around 36 by 48, I believe, somewhere in that scale. 10 drawings I did in the early 80s that were done in the same format, and consciously decided to do, and I spent maybe about a half a year working on these drawings as well as other works in pretty much black and white or monochrome. I decided to eliminate a lot of color. Prior to this, I had used a lot of color in my work, and you'll see that return kind of in and out throughout the pieces. The first two are black and whites, and this is another drawing. This one probably from around 1980, I would say mid-80s, somewhere around that period, after I'd done that earlier series, which was much more aggressive. I think you can see the difference maybe in just the feeling of the two pieces, the other one having a much more darker, ominous feeling, and although this one might also have that for you, just in the way people interpret images such as a bone image, it's meant to be a much more positive image in a sense. It's a fairly tiny drawing, so it seems unusual, at least for me, to see it on this scale, but actually kind of interesting. It's only maybe 11 inches, not quite square, so maybe by 10 by 11 inches. I had done a whole series of small drawings in black and white as well, and just titled Bone Light. Some of the titles, as you hear them, may give you some kind of a reference point to look at the work and maybe think about it in a certain way. They're not literal. If it brings to mind something, can help you connect to the work, that's great. If it doesn't, I don't do it intentionally to create a mystery around it. It's just the way I've been doing it. This is a slide of an semi-installation, a venture into three dimensions in this front section here, the closest area of the slide, a bed piece. And as you could see, or as you will see in several other works, in certain images, I guess I call them icons now of imagery, reoccur, whether it's certain kinds of furniture, whether it's something that's connected to the room space itself, or whether it's that constant image of the bone that I'll probably get a lot of questions about, that reoccurs throughout the pieces. There's two paintings in the back here. The front piece is just simply titled Bone Bed, and then the two paintings in back, which are around 5 by 6 foot in scale each. The one on the left is titled Falling Athlete, and the one on the right is Falling Bed. And those are actually acrylic on canvas, and then the front sculptural piece is mixed mediums. Around that last slide that you looked at, it was dating probably around 1987, 88, and this comes from around that same period. And what had occurred at that time, or not occurred, just something that just happens, I think, with different artists, is I had come to a point with painting where, although I was still interested in it, in ideas from it, color, things that you can do with painting, or things that you gain from learning how to paint, but I became more fascinated with real space and three-dimensional environments. So this was one of the last literal paintings that I did, and I stopped painting for around a good 8 years. That is the literal sense of painting, but I always considered what I was doing later, still painting as well. And this is titled Broken Bone at 5 a.m., around 5 by 6 foot, and again from the late 80s. By this point too, I think you could see from the first two slides, by this point I had eliminated images of literal figures. in the work and had reduced it down to objects. But objects like the bone and even some of the quasi-furniture-like images as substitutes for human figures. Also very, a lot of the work is influenced by literature, things that I read, novels, poems, things of that nature. And then this moves, you know, very far into, one might look at it and say, well, that definitely is not painting. And I understand how someone could, you know, think that about it, but for me it still was about using color materials in a certain way that for me were informed by my experiences in painting. This is titled Street Bed, and it was a project for a space downtown called Sushi, which still exists, but at that time it was in a different locale, who commissioned artists in San Diego to create pieces as public pieces for outdoor spaces, commenting on just the urban environment or the public space. And so mine was in the form of this street bed that, I won't get into the whole details, but basically was a comment on the idea of homelessness, the idea of the streets as literally a bed for individuals who have no other place to sleep. And so the whole piece was fabricated in a way to echo all that, all those kinds of ideas, whether one, you know, gets it right away or not. And that was 88. This is, I mentioned to you that I also have, along with being a studio-based artist, have also been very open to the idea of collaborations, of working with other people, sometimes lots of other people, in creating work. And by the, I think one of the impetuses behind my not only exhaustion, or this feeling that I exhausted what I wanted to do with literal painting in the late 80s, and my move into installations, and if you want to call them sculptures, I don't really consider myself a sculptor, but things that are three-dimensional, had to do with my involvement with a group known as the Border Art Workshop, Taller de Arte Fronterizo, based out of the Centro Cultural here in San Diego. Group of artists who came together and produced works that were essentially collaborations dealing with issues about immigration, about the border, about hybrid culture. And so this is a collaborative piece somewhat with two other artists from the Border Art Workshop, a woman named Emily Hicks, and also a couple of other artists in the group who just helped me fabricate the installation. The part on the bottom, which is this quasi-wrestling ring or boxing ring, if you will, with barbed wire, and then the bottom is a drawing done with charcoal and paint on the bottom. So it's all sort of a mix of materials. But again, for me, it still seemed to me like something about painting. I always felt that when I would create these things, I always thought still as a painter, even though it was embedded in more, I guess one could say, images that meant to be read in specific ways connected with the larger projects that the group was doing. And it was part of a Border Realities exhibit. We did annual ones at the Centro, and this was one of the installations in this almost kind of maze-like in space that included several installations. Once again, and although this parts of it were about collaboration with the Border Art Workshop, in other words, this piece titled Encinitas Gardens, which I did in 1989, late 80s, in three different locales. The first version of this piece was done for the with the Border Art Workshop group for our first exhibit outside of San Diego County. I don't think it was our first exhibit outside of San Diego County. Our first exhibit on the East Coast in New York at a place called Artist Space, and we did a show called Vidas Perdidas, Lost Lives. And this was part of the maze of installations for that show. I did two other versions. The second one was at the Centro, and then the third one, this one that you're looking at, I did, I produced myself, although it was informed by ideas with the collaborative group in San Jose at the Institute of Contemporary Art there, again, as I say, late 80s. And this is kind of a tunnel piece that you walk through, and as you come close to the interior, you're confronted with these simulated containers of pesticides. The piece itself was a comment on the agricultural industry, especially up in Encinitas with the flower fields and the use of toxic materials, chemicals, pesticides, and its effect, some quite large effect on the population of immigrant workers. So it was meant to be sort of as a homage to those workers and a memorial, but also sort of a confrontation with the reality of these things, essentially, they're very beautiful objects, the flowers, but that have this undercurrent of a darker side in terms of what happens to those individuals who work in that industry. And another installation piece, I had been with the Board Art Workshop for quite a few years and then left to collaborate with a couple of other artists, one being Guillermo Gomez Peña, performance artist, writer, multidisciplinary artist. And we had done a project for a space in Finland prior to this piece here, which is titled 500 Years of Genocide. It was a piece we had done for a large public art project in Finland. And the floor map that you see was actually produced as a vertical panel, about a little larger than that, actually, about 6 foot by 8 foot on a mirrored surface. And next to that panel was a text panel that had some of the text that you see in here. Unfortunately, I don't have any close-ups of that. But the piece was a comment. It was during the quincentennial celebration of the discovery of Americas. And so it was sort of a counter to that idea and as a memorial to indigenous races in terms of the devastation of a lot of indigenous races. But you can see the reoccurrence of certain images like the bone iconography. The map image was done, painted on the floor, and this is in an installation I did in Barcelona at Fundació Joan Miró, where they have a small space under the museum to invite artists, current contemporary artists, to do projects. The foundation itself is, as they say, a museum of Miró's work, all of the work that he did, as well as collections of work that he had of other artists. But I was lucky enough to be invited to work on a project, and Guillermo and I decided to reformat the piece for Finland for this as an installation. Unfortunately, Guillermo wasn't able to come out because being as in demand a person as he was, I think he was in Russia at the time performing. So I, which didn't mind, got to go out and create the piece there. You can see in the installation there's several kind of pillars, again with this motif of bones. I think I have a little close-up of that. Two little curtained rooms. There's a lot of aspects of this that there's no use in even talking about them a lot because they were sound generated as poem and sound pieces that envelop the space as well. But you can get at least a sense of the visuals here. I had these large, about 8 foot half circles against the large pillar walls that when you came up close, those images of bones extended down seemingly endlessly down through the floor. And now we'll switch back to images that I began creating I actually made a conscious decision to return to painting in, I believe it was around 1990, must have been about 94, 95, somewhere around that period. I had been collaborating, I have a lot of slides also of my collaborations with Richard Liu, and he had gone on sabbatical, so it was a time when I figured, well, I had some ideas about painting and drawing again in the literal sense, and so I got back to it, and I did a wide variety of work when I got back to working with painting and drawing. Decided to do a whole series again of black and white works, but keeping them as abstract as possible, although they still have, at least for me, a certain feeling that you might get from some of my other work, although it's not, since it isn't figurative and since it is more abstract, maybe others might not see that. This is... I don't remember the title of this piece. I did quite a few. I did maybe about 20 to 30 of these drawings on paper, fairly large-scale drawings. And these were with tempera paint, just black tempera paint on a white vellum paper. This one I do remember the title of. This is called Monica's Secret Circle. And actually, it was in reference to my youngest daughter and some little walks we used to have close to this lake that we live by. And it's a little sort of anecdotal thing that I'll have to get into. But the image was generated by these kind of walks and something that we had discovered there. The drawing, though, for me, was somewhat of an experiment with two different kinds of paper. The vellum that I had done that last drawing on, that's underneath the top layer here, which is on a transparent vellum. And so they were layered drawings. I would do an underneath section, do a drawing on top and layer it over, and then it would create this kind of soft, very painterly feel. And to me, it, as far as the black and white ones, it seemed the most painterly. And I think sort of little by little led me back to, once again, painting. It's a huge jump here, I know, but there's all kinds of other things that happened in the interim in creating the work. This piece here, these last two pieces you'll see are the most recent. Again, I don't have slides of the most recent work, so this is very late 90s. And this one here titled Fragile Sanity. And it is a piece that is so unusual to look at right now because it's about, I think 10 inches by 6 inches. It's a very tiny painting, so to see it on the scale, for me, distorts it. It works okay for you in that sense. It kind of jars me when I see it this large. They were meant to be the pieces I was doing at this time, small, kind of almost like books. Books always have had an important part to do with inspiration and making work. More importantly, not books, but literature and what other people write. I think I admire the most writers. I love, obviously, other artists being one, but writers have always been those doors to other ways of making my ideas resonate, I think, with things that connect with other disciplines. And you'll see a second version of this as a three-dimensional somewhat piece, and this is it. It's probably a little bit bigger than the original, but the first one was on canvas, and this one is constructed out of wood and then painted. So that gives you a sense of the range, hopefully, of the things I've done. And I know it's fairly quick that we're doing this, but we don't have a lot of time here. What I'm going to do is I think I'll go back and I'll talk just a little bit more about one of the installations, and then I'll come back to one of the paintings and maybe make a few comments about that. So, if you bear with me, let's see if this reverse works good on here. Okay, I'll go ahead and do this one from Barcelona. The thing that fascinated me about working on this piece, which is, as I mentioned to you, is titled 500 Years of Genocide, was the connection I had with Guillermo Gomez Peña in terms of his writing and the ideas that were being discussed amongst a lot of indigenous artists, cultural thinkers, individuals that were at least active in creating a counter celebration to the whole Columbus celebration that was going on. A counter celebration, in a sense, as a way to confront those issues of the destruction of a lot of indigenous races. So when we created this piece in collaboration, we threw around a lot of ideas. The text was very concise. I think that was more because of Guillermo's working on it, although I did contribute there. But he also respected, I think, my own sensibilities as a visual artist more in what I did. And so I tended to work more with the visuals and create at least the floor map here. And here the map is meant as an image of this kind of crossbone that obviously creates a sense of danger and of something ominous. And then these fragments or these sections of map pieces, more importantly, countries that are floating and disconnected. Floating in what? Well, a black section of material that is meant to be as a kind of a metaphor for oil, one of the most natural resources in terms of the earth, but one that historically, in terms of what occurs with especially imperialism, with the interest in gaining land from other countries by certain countries to have that resource. And so the piece was meant to work metaphorically in that sense. There's other elements to it that can't be seen in this slide, barely can be seen. If you look to the right there, that light bulb that's hanging is hanging over a white plate with a pool of black oil in it as well. But without the sound, again, the poem that goes with it, it doesn't have quite as much, I think, power to it. I was really fascinated with what happened, though, with the images of bones, which were meant to, the bone is a symbol of the human body, is a skeletal structure, is the thing that's left that is examined and exhumed by anthropologists and scientists ad infinitum for centuries, and that can tell us about past things, yet what can it tell us? And then with different cultures, it means different things, especially with indigenous cultures. Bones are very spiritual objects and have a lot of meaning. So all those things run through, I think can run through one's mind, at least they do through my own. And so I've always used them in that way, leave them open, but I'm fascinated with their shape, the way I can create different permutations and patterns. And I think my favorite part of this whole installation was just standing next to that wall and peering down into that sort of infinity of those bones descending down. And it's something that's almost not easy to verbalize, and oftentimes that's the way it is with visual things, is that you can say a lot about it, but it's almost better just to, you know, kind of take it in through those other senses as opposed to just the cognitive one. Okay, now I'll go back to this and I'll finish up here so I don't run over Brian's time here. This piece was fascinating to me when I worked on it in that, again, as I said, I had been away from painting for a while and I finally felt I had somewhat hit a stride in things that I was making. And I gone back and forth, as you can see, through the majority of, or a lot of the work I've done, I've gone back and forth through complexity, images that have a lot going on and that just seem very busy with lots of stuff there, but hopefully connected as a whole through their compositional structure. But over the years, and I think it had to do more at those times when I would shift back to black and white and work solely in black and white for a while, and when I would return to color, I found I often returned to color and was more austere with its use, but also more, I guess, concise with the amount of images that I put in there. And I like that, not that, and it's almost contradictory to, for those of you who've seen the two pieces I have down in the gallery here, now I'm going back in the opposite direction, but that I think that's just the way it is with artists, or certain artists, at least myself, that you have this desire and you go in one direction and then you sort of exhaust that and you move somewhere else. But at this point, when I did this in the late 90s, what I love the most, I think, about this piece is its simplicity. But at the same time that it was simple, it seemed to have a lot more power in terms of ways in which one might enter into thinking about what you're looking at as maybe a contemplative space, maybe a meditative one, but maybe not. I mean, someone else may see it as very threatening, as actually very charged in a certain provocative sense. But I've always loved that about being able to work with images that are pregnant with a lot of different meanings, and hence the use of bones, of light bulbs, of windows, of beds. Those are all images that obviously are somewhat, maybe can be banal, prosaic, just everyday images, but they're also images that are completely open to interpretation, and oftentimes we think about those different kinds, if you think of those ones I listed, think of them in very specific ways that have to do with how they connect to our lives, especially spaces that we live in, we sleep in, we dream in, where we get sick in, all of those things. So I think the reason this piece, you know, had that for me, unfortunately I don't own it anymore. It was kind of a mistake that it got sold anyway, but that's one of the things that happened. But it is that kind of thing where you come across certain pieces when you're working over a period of time that are important to you, and one thing I try to tell students is hang on to that work. Don't do as I did, and although it wasn't my fault that I don't own it anymore, it was a mistake. And it helps to have those works because you can look at them and get other ideas, and they're just things that regenerate sometimes when you get to a point where you're kind of stuck, you don't know which way to go. Sometimes it's a matter of going completely opposite of this, as really what I think I'm doing now is I've been looking at this piece a lot and some similar ones to it that I did around this time. And the work that I'm doing now is very much outside it, yet still within certain ideas that I produced here. Now, at this point, because I think I've gone about 30 minutes, I'll take a couple of questions and then I'll let Brian get started here. I don't know, I guess we can do them in the dark. If there's any, does anybody want any particular slide put up here to ask a question about? If you don't have any questions, then we can just move on to Brian. You know, that's a very good question, because I thought about that. I was thinking of putting together slides that just showed the origin of when I first used the image of the bone. It really came about through the figurative work I was doing earlier, back in the late 70s, early 80s, that was highly figurative. In other words, literal, you know, people in there, although they were somewhat exaggerated and surreal. Little by little, as I started to become more austere, like this one here with the compositions, I found that the only thing left was this image of the bone as a representation of the human body. But it also connected with, I always collect and cut out things. I found a card. It was a card for, I don't know, it was a chiropractor or what it was, but it had this, that particular kind, not that one there, but the other bone shape, what's a fibia? See, I don't even know what they're called. I'm just fascinated with the image. That particular one came from this black and white little kind of illustration, and then I just cut it out and started using it and repeating it and permutating it. But it really was the fact that I think I like the idea that the bone is about the human body, but it's a very austere representation of it. Plus, it's just so loaded with meaning. And for me, it's just a fascinating image visually to work with. Yeah, well, with the light bulb, and I mentioned to you beds, windows, bones, the light bulb, although it may seem like, well, that doesn't seem like such an iconic image, but actually the word I wanted to grasp is archetype. The archetype, as, you know, sort of Jungian analysis, the idea of a thing that we all see and recognize that is very ancient. Now, one might look at a bone or the image of a window, which is a cross form, and that those are ancient symbols. And the light bulb, you might think, well, that's not an ancient symbol. But in terms of let's say, technology, it's one of the earliest manifestations of you know, that sort of technology that really changed the whole notion of what light is about in human life. The fact that it still remains that particular shape of a light bulb, and I'm talking about the plain old, banal, prosaic light bulb, is pretty amazing to me that it exists today. If you think of other things in technology, products, computers especially, those things change and look so different from one month to the next sometimes. So to have that remain, to me, becomes sort of an archetype, an iconic image of the beginnings of industrial society. But also, too, it's very loaded with meaning, the idea that it's a container that gives out light. But it's also, if you look at the shape of that simple light bulb, it also is very figurative. It almost looks like the shape of a pregnant woman, if you will. It also looks like a teardrop. It also looks like an egg. Again, it's a very loaded image, has very, very pregnant in meaning. And again, as a visual artist, it's just a fascinating shape to play with. It's not privy to my creativity, because there's been countless artists who have used that image. And I also have taken a lot of inspiration from theater, film, stage sets, and so I use a lot of times things that I see in there, and oftentimes you'll see stages lit just with a single bulb, and I kind of am fascinated with that. But there was one installation, it was part of a collaborative one that I worked on with the Board Art Workshop, where actually the light bulbs were upside down, were coming from the floor up. That came actually from a drawing I had, a little sketch, and there's probably been some instances where I have put it in a different position, but there's not any real, you know, kind of complex reason for why I did that. I think it just instinctually, that's how I've worked with them. Especially the bones, I tend to hang them because they're also substitutes for the idea of light bulbs and lights. Okay, let's give Brian a chance to do his here.
But I wanted to make sure that you got to see Brian before he shows. Thanks, Robert. That was wonderful. Thank you. Well, now we'll have Professor Brian Gillis, who just joined our faculty. And I thought that this would be a nice forum for him to talk to us about his work. Thank you.
Thank you. I figured before I started to show you slides, I'd explain what I'm after here. And I guess I'm still kind of, I feel like I'm developing as a storyteller and as a maker. And so I figured the most productive or the most efficient route to take here is to show you things that I look at and show you things that I'm interested in making and give you an idea of the things that I'm thinking about. and kind of preference that although I do have titles for things and I do have ideas about things, I'm not sure that I have any conclusive answers, as probably most artists feel. So I pretty much am in a state of exploration, and I'm not really interested at this point in saying that I know exactly what I'm doing, but I'll give you an idea of what I'm thinking about. So here we have an image of the Virgin of Guadalupe on the right and Lady Pink on the left. And at the time that I started to, I'm gonna show you a body of work from about 2 years ago, I started to think about iconography and the development of icons and how they start off as iconoclasts. And the reality is Mary was a woman at one point, and she was a mother, and she got sick, and she probably said the wrong thing a few times, and she was a person. And I started to get interested in this notion. I heard this quote from Napoleon, and he said, "Fact is really just a bunch of fables that that more than one person agrees on." And so I started to get interested on the way that we develop icons as a collective. And so on the left is Lady Pink, and she was a prominent graffiti artist in the 80s. And I think being a woman, she became more of an icon in that not too many women were graffiti artists then. And also, as you can see, on the black part of the subway car, she put in white, pink. And everybody else in that subway car did it in black. And so she kind of went against the grain and became an icon. So along these lines, I made a piece that's called Three Iconoclast. And it's got the image of the Virgin of Guadalupe on the back. I was thinking of the way that some people tattoo the Virgin Mary on their back, and in Lassie's mouth is the Venus of Wellendorf, otherwise known as the Woman of Wellendorf, and then we have Lassie. And I started to use Lassie as this protagonist. I was thinking of her as a champion of the American, you know, or the Americana. And I started to think about these icons that we have, and I had recently read this article about the Venus of Wellendorf, and for those of you who don't know, it's probably in the first five pages of every art history book you're gonna pick up. And it's this limestone statue that was found in Wellendorf, Austria, 27,000 years ago. And everything we assume about it is that it was the, it's a votive statue for a fertility religion. And I read this article that was talking about, okay, what if it was a doll for a little kid? Or at the time they had found a bunch of these that were made out of raw clay, and they were thinking, okay, well, what if the women were the heads of these clans and the men were jealous and they made these dolls and they'd throw them into a fire and they'd explode? And so there's a, we surmise that they're pinnacle of this goddess religion, but the reality is we don't really know what they were. And so we've agreed that the Venus of Wellendorf is a votive statue for a fertility religion, but we don't know. And I think similarly, through thousands of years of us agreeing on the Virgin as being this icon, she becomes one. And the same thing goes for Lassie. You know, the reality is Lassie was never played by a girl dog. And Lassie was, in fact, just a dog. So just all of these years of us agreeing that Lassie was this hero, she kind of becomes one. I'm going to try to move through these fast, but I often have trouble. I talk a lot. So I'm interested in accessing generally recognizable images and things like that. And on the right is a Ming Dynasty bowl. Ming Dynasty, I think, was probably about 400 or 500 years ago in China. And this blue on white is pretty characteristic of that bowl. And at that time, starting in about the 16th or 17th century, the Europeans started to import this Ming Dynasty ware, and they wanted to have porcelain. But they didn't have the available clays in Europe to make porcelain, so they'd fake it. And I thought it was so interesting that when toilets started to be developed, and we see a lot of Dutch ware that has the Ming Dynasty design sensibility, they kind of just ripped off the design sensibility and put it anywhere. And so I'm interested in doing that too. And I made a piece that is entitled, "I Went to Jingdezhen, China, and All I Got Was This Lousy Idea." And I started to think about Lassie as being this icon, but also something that can champion our ideals. And at the time I was living in New York, and I was living in Western New York, my girlfriend lived in New York City, and we'd go to Times Square, and I was always so enamored by the signs in Times Square, and how in a lot of ways they inform the things that we should buy or the things that we should believe in. So I put these light bulb forms all over the front, and I used an abstracted Ming Dynasty design as a wallpaper effect on the rest of the piece. And I'm not gonna go into everything here. I included this to talk a little bit about my affinity towards monument and something that is almost an ephemeral monument. And on the left is a cartoon made by Rube Goldberg. Many of you have heard of him, and it's Rube Goldberg's new career machine. And after being a cartoonist for 30 years, he kind of just decided to become a sculptor. And it's a really punny and quite sharp way of exploring that. And on the right is this old wall in Shanghai, and the wall itself is probably only 80 years old. But in the background, there's this new townhouse complex that was built at the new Shanghai University campus, which was built for 80,000 people, and they built it in a year and a half. And I went there, and I was teaching a sculpture class, and all of a sudden, in the middle of nowhere, this metropolis just sprouted up. And I was riding around, and I saw this wall, or the remnants of this wall, and in the background, I saw this new townhouse. And I started to think about how this wall, in some ways, could be a monument for change, or the way that this piece of land is in flux. And I started to think about this Rube Goldberg new career machine as some sort of a testimonial or a monument or memorial to him, maybe made by him and for him. And I started to think about, you know, here we are. We generally recognize a monument as being a statue of a famous person or some sort of a plaque in a famous battlefield. But really, anything could be if you agree on it or if you see it as such. So I'm interested on how this wall that wasn't meant to be a monument, if I frame it as such, could be. And how this new career machine by Rube Goldberg could also be. On the right is a sculpture called House by a British artist named Rachel Whiteread. And on the left is a found frozen custard sign that I found. And I guess that's kind of redundant. But anyways, I started to think about how even a found object can be a testimonial for what was. Because I bet most of the people in this room have never had frozen custard, me included. And in Western New York, it's really great because, and probably most of the people in this room don't know this either, but the ice cream shops in Western New York are really only open from about April to August, and they shut down. And they don't have frozen custard anymore. And I found this, and I thought about how this was a remnant from a lost time. And it's very indicative of the Northeastern culture, you know, a very specific part of culture. And similarly, this house made by Rachel Whiteread, basically what she did is took one of these old houses that that we all kind of equate with suburbia or urban landscapes in London. If anybody's ever seen the Help movie by the Beatles, you see rows of these buildings just like a foot apart. And neighborhood was being demolished to make a parking structure. So she took one of these old houses and she filled it with cement and broke away the house. And I don't have details with me, but you could see there's remnants of wallpaper and carvings on wood where maybe a little boy carved notches for every push-up he could do or something like that. And it tells a story of what used to be. Maybe I'll get a hang of doing this eventually. So I started to think about monuments and how they can also be ephemeral or transient. And on the right is a piece that I made called Posted, What You Can and Can't Keep. And on the left is a familiar image. It's from World War II, I believe, and it has since been made into a three-dimensional monument. and this was a picture taken from Life magazine. And I always thought it was so weird that we'd go and stick a flag in a place that really isn't America, and it's just this weird concept that we try to own things that are really not ownable. And the image that I used on the right is a sign that you'd find in a forest that says posted, private property, no hunting, fishing, trapping, strictly forbidden. And I always thought it was interesting how we're pretty much these organisms that can't survive anywhere. We have so many rules. And it makes sense to me that if we're hungry, we should be able to fish anywhere in moderation, and we should be able to hunt anywhere in moderation. But we have all these rules that we set up for ourselves. Who thinks I'm going too fast? Quick, anybody? Okay. I'm gonna try to go faster. So I was walking through the hardware store, and I found this can of spray paint that was hot pink. And I looked at it and I thought, wow, that's a really beautiful color, but I've given it such a bad rap. I always think of it as this 1980s color that you see in bad t-shirts and bad sunglasses. So I was still using Lassie as the protagonist in these pieces, and this is called Burdens and How to Use Hot Pink. And so I tried to put it in a context that the hot pink could be exploited as maybe being a beautiful color. This is called On Appropriation and Inundation. And at this time I was playing a lot with the book imagery as a metaphor for learning, as a metaphor for being an open book. And at the same time, I was really educating myself in the history of art. And for those of you who don't know, in 1917, Marcel Duchamp was invited to be in a group show. And this was a time when painters were painters and sculptors were sculptors. And he took a urinal, and on the side of the urinal, he wrote "Our Mutt, 1917, and he put it in the show. And it pretty much opened up the world for people to use ready-mades or found objects. So I kind of made a testament to the things that Marcel Duchamp opened up, using Lassie as the protagonist and having her being punished, having to look in the corner. And so I found this old door, and you know, we've all heard of Aldous Huxley's Doors of Perception, or maybe we've thought about doors as an interesting metaphor for thresholds between different things. And so I found this old door from probably about 1890. And at the time, I was living in this place called Alfred, New York, which was at one time the hub of ceramic tile production in North America. And before I was going to a school there, the New York State College of Ceramics at Alfred, which was made in the 1890s, I believe, in a collaboration between a British ceramic manufacturer and a brick maker in America, and they made this New York State School of Clay Working. And I started to think about how we always monumentalize all these things that we deem important. You know, there's Columbus Day, but you know, the reality is Columbus committed genocide within 50 years. And we have President's Day, and we have monuments for these battlefields. And we don't generally have monuments for things that might have been a positive influence in the development of America, maybe because they didn't change things that much. And so here, I think at the turn of the century, there were something like 500 different factories throughout North America that produced ceramic terracotta tiles that we see all over the buildings in the Midwest and the Northeast. And by the Depression, there was a handful of them, and today there's only two. And so this is a testament or a memorial to that lost art, or that, you know, this was the first fireproofing in America. And so I made a testament to the Alfred Clay Company. And this was an old advertisement, and it says Alfred Clay Company, manufacturer of roof tiles and terracotta trimmings. And the image is of the old kiln house. And all the found objects sculptures are molds that are made from life. So this is about 3 feet by 6.5 feet. And so I started to deal with this this can and fruit imagery. And throughout a couple of years, I was playing around with different metaphors, and I started to see it as a potential for nourishment or substance, and the cans as being a metaphor for potential. And at the time, my sister-in-law was pregnant with the first child of the next generation of our family. And I started to think about how here she's growing with the life of the future of my genes. And I started to think about how in a lot of ways it's a symbol for nourishment and the potential that my genes can live on. And so I made this piece, and unfortunately I don't have a slide of the plaque that went with it, but I have I'll read to you the title. I was playing around with different things to try to get it to have a feeling of a family tree, or somehow having it be a pile of fruit. And it's called Ethan Benjamin Gillis. And then under it is a list of all the men in my family that came here from the 1850s. And it's Benjamin Ben Gillis, Bennett Ben Benjamin, Samuel Ben Bennett, Morris Ben Bennett, Herbert Ben Bennett, Benjamin Ben Herbert, Arthur Ben Herbert, Joshua Ben Arthur, Brian Ben Arthur, Daniel Ben Arthur, Ethan Ben Joshua, Wednesday, March 13th, 2002, 6:52 a.m. And I used, as most of you probably noticed, I used the word Ben a lot. And in the Hebrew tradition, which is the tradition I'm from, Ben means son of. And I have a Hebrew name as well as an English name. And my English name is Brian Sean Gillis. And my Hebrew name is Baruch Shalom Ben Avrum, which means blessed peace, son of Avrum. And in Middle Eastern tradition, similar to Osama bin Laden, it means son, you use your father's first name as your last name. So I tried to use the plaque as a way of having this imagery be a family tree. Am I talking too much? Okay. Oh, that's right. This is called, geez, I could never remember. Okay, this is called While You Were Sleeping, Itinerant Introspection and Individuation, and then in parentheses, short stories by wannabes and people with low self-confidence. And this is kind of a tribute to the first time that I was truly introspective, as I think I was 16. And when I was about 16, I had been a graffiti muralist for about 4 years, just living it, painting every night. And I realized one day that I was a graffiti artist because I wanted to say that I was a graffiti artist. And I lost that love of making art. And it was this catastrophic realization to me. And in a lot of ways, it got me to realize a lot of tendencies that I have. And it was the first time I was truly introspective. So I thought this door was an interesting metaphor. And on the front, there's the alphabet written in tag language, so to speak. And then there's sign language that says PJ Watts Crip Gang. And at the time, when I was 16, I had some friends who were in the projects of Watts Crip Gang. And they're the most notorious Crip Gang in North America. So I thought I was this big man. And when I realized that not only were these people not my friends, but I'm not a big man, it really was pretty hard on me. So on the back of this door, I strapped a chalkboard to it, and I wrote standards, as if, you know, Mrs. Barnes would make me write standards for hitting Susie in class or something. And it starts off by saying, I will not waste paint, I will not scar Dad's heart, I will not choose friends blindly, I will not lie, cheat, and steal. And it's just, I tried to be honest with the things that were going through my mind. You know, I will not be judgmental. And in a lot of ways, I think it was a self-portrait, but it was more like a monument or a memorial to the first time I was truly introspective. And it was also the first time I signed a piece in probably, I guess, 10 years. since I had done graffiti. And I stopped signing work because I always felt like, you know, if you have a pot or you have a painting and there's a signature on it, it's always so foreign from the imagery that that is being painted or on a pot, and always just looks so foreign. And I was always very interested in the idea of the unknown craftsman and how something could be made and the work could stand alone without the presence of the maker. So I felt that this was an appropriate venue to actually put my signature on. And this piece is called Home Sweet Home. And at the time, I had been living in this house that was probably 150 years old, and there's this old piano in the house, and the ground was just rotting away, and it was sagging. The whole house, this three-story house, was sagging under the weight of this piano. And I had found this humongous bay window, single-pane bay window in western New York, where we had snow in the middle of May. And I was thinking about how this bay window, in a lot of ways, for those of you who have lived in snowy weather, is your communication with the outside world. And so I started to think about it as this sign and this way to communicate. And if you can't see, it's covered with light bulbs, porcelain light bulbs. Robert and I kind of have a lot of the same imagery, kind of think of it. Dog, I guess the bones and the dogs could be related. And in the middle of this big sign is an old throw switch, like you'd see in The Bride of Frankenstein. And I was interested in implying this light, this energy. And I made this piece after 9/11. And like most people, my first response to 9/11 was, you know, I was really taken aback, and I was filled with sorrow and sadness, and I was instantaneously very patriotic, and pretty quickly after that, I started to question, okay, well, why is this happening here? You know, did we maybe do something? And I started to think about how maybe this is a time for us to look at what we're doing. So my intentions with this piece, although I don't know if they're being communicated, is that it's a time for us to wake up and look at home sweet home. And I had always thought of the saying home sweet home has been this very serene, pleasant saying that's very comfortable. And just by putting a now at the end, it gives it this urgency and takes this this grandma's needlepoint over the couch thing and makes it maybe the center of a march or something, some sort of protest. I think I'm going through this faster than I thought. Geez. This one's called Greenest Grass and Groceries for Mrs. Wexler. And for those of you who have had, and then after Groceries for Mrs. Wexler, there's a grocery list, half in Yiddish and half in English. And I won't read you the list right now, probably because I can't pronounce any of the words anyways. But for those of you who have had immigrant grandparents or parents, once they get older, their simple day-to-day things tend to meld the two worlds that they are in or come from. And so I was interested in trying to communicate, you know, here I am, raised Jewish. I had a bar mitzvah. I grew up in suburbia in Los Angeles, where most of my friends weren't Jewish. And the extent of my relationship to my heritage was that the only reasons to fight were if somebody hit you first or called you a dirty Jew. And I knew nothing of my tradition. I just went through the motions to get it done with, so I never had to go to temple anymore. And I realized through having friends who, a close friend of mine is first generation from Sicily, and I have friends who are from Mexico and other countries, and it seems to me that the mother tongue really only lasts about three generations. You know, the reality is that although I know some Yiddish, I probably won't marry a Jewish woman, and I probably, my children won't learn Yiddish. And when all is said and done, nobody speaks Yiddish anymore. So this is a monument or a testament for the idea of what gets left behind when you come to America. And in Hebrew, Hebrew letters were the way that Yiddish would be written in, say, the Yiddish Daily Journal or these immigrant newspapers. And so on the right of, I'm looking at the arrow sign on the left, on the right of the sign is Hebrew letters that are Yiddish words, and they're taken from the Yiddish Daily Journal, which was a journal that mostly immigrants bought that I think was first started in the late 1880s. And it would have everything from current events to letters to the editor. And I had recently, before I made this piece, read a book called The Bintel Brief. And it was a conglomeration of all the letters to the editor for the past 110, 20 years, I guess. And, you know, it starts off where there's a letter from a girl from the 1890s who's about 15, and she came to America, and her only family is her uncle, and her uncle is physically abusing her. And then there's other stories about people who come here and are working in sweatshops, and it's real life. And it was interesting to me how this journal was kind of the center of this these immigrants who came here. And so that kind of melds into English as you get closer to the arrow. And I was thinking about this as somewhat of a burden or something that has a wheelbarrow essence to it. And all of this work is has clay as one of the attributes, and I'm interested in trying to exploit clay's archival properties, where clay is probably one of the most archival materials that we have around. And a lot of what we know about cultures from Peru and Greek cultures come from the stuff that we find on their pots. We know what their daily life is like. We know how they dealt with children being born and coming of age ceremonies. And so I'm interested in making these memorials kind of like time capsules or things that years from now, 5,000 years from the future, the archaeologists might find and see all this iron oxide from where the steel melted away, and then see a bunch of these clay tiles and try to surmise what this thing was. And hopefully they'll learn a little bit about what one person might have been thinking about at that time. This is, with this work, I really went fast through this stuff. I apologize. But with this work, I really started to think about relationships and how I'd have a room filled with these things that I saw as stories or fables or allegories or folklore, folk tales, snippets or things from lion contests. And on their own, I think that they exist as these storytellers or fablers, but together they kind of start to tell a story. And I included the slide on the right because I started to see connections between these pieces and how inevitably these pieces would start to inform each other. And on the left is a close-up of a sticker that I put on there. With this show of probably the last 10 pieces, all of these things are really big and really heavy, and I think Mesa hired me to be the guy who carries heavy stuff around, but I can't carry everything around. So I'd have all these guys help me, and I thought it was interesting how there was a guy named Stephen Galley, Mark DeBernardis, Owen Nelson, and Kevin Drake, who helped me out a lot. And here we are in America, and all of us come from different backgrounds, France, Italy, the British Isles, and we're all here together in relatively the same socioeconomic or cultural place. And so I included this sticker as kind of like an advertisement for the sign company. It says factory direct, finest qualities, sailors or rent, lowest prices. And it was kind of like an extra thank you for them. And I think this sticker is getting me to think about subtle nuances and how maybe the Marcel Duchamp reference could be something for somebody who is art smart or in the know. But maybe also how the fact that it says R Mutt and it's on a lassie, it could also just refer to this tongue-in-cheek comment on lassie being our mutt as America. I've pretty much thrown out everything I've made for the past 8 years. And in a lot of ways, it's been very liberating because I never had the MoMA knocking down my door for a solo show, and nobody was ever buying anything. So I was able to just experiment and really be a student. And I think it's important for people at the college level to explore and push themselves and not worry about keeping anything. You know, I think what Robert mentioned about keeping some important works is very important, you know, just to refer to later. But as soon as you can release the preciousness of a single piece, that's when you could really push things and not worry about making these great pieces of work, but just be more interested in the exploration and the investigation as an artist. I was able to keep these because I finally got a real job and I was able to rent a U-Haul. So I was able to keep some of them. Yeah, it's a conglomeration of Hebrew prayers and then different things that talk about from the Yiddish Daily Journal that talks about books being handed down from rabbi to rabbi. The Yiddish language is written using Hebrew letters. And maybe for those of you who read Hebrew or understand some of the religion, one of the things that's repeated throughout the piece is Shema Yisrael, Adonai Eloheha, Adonai Echad. And that means, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. And this is a mantra that soothsayers and people from all walks of life have spoken for thousands of years. And it's something that people say in religious ceremonies, and it was something that people would say at the lead-tipped whip of the Romans. Their last words, similar to the movie Braveheart, where he yelled freedom, they would yell this mantra. And basically, the basis of the Jewish religion is that that the Lord is one. And that's a lot of the problems that Jews had throughout time. So in this piece, that's one of the things that starts in Hebrew and then is translated in English. Well, I was thinking, maybe I could rewind it. I was thinking of about illumination, and the back is gold, and the slide doesn't really tell it very well, but you could see on the side how the back legs of the dog is kind of illuminated a little bit. And I was thinking of the circle around the Venus as a spotlight, and how, there might be a lot of ideas all over the place, but we spotlight on one idea and kind of decide that that's the idea. It's a lawn ornament that I found in Western New York, and I made a mold of it, and I made it out of terracotta. Well, thanks for coming.
Bright angels above,
if I just had